in the back of their minds are saying, well, can't you fix me so that sometime later on I can do that? So this idea has to be smashed. And the first page of the third chapter concentrates most of its most of its paragraphs on that one issue. So we take our newcomer to the doctor's opinion, and we have them read it, and we explain it to them. Then we go down to the next paragraph on page 26 in the doctor's opinion. Here again is something that we as sponsors ought to recognize and understand and take it to heart, because it applies directly to us, that frothy emotional appeal seldom suffices. And that refers to things like, look what you're doing to your family, look what you're doing to yourself, what's the matter, don't you have any willpower, the Bible says this, the minister says that, your boss says this and that. And it's, and we listen as drunks, but down deep inside we're saying, so what? This isn't the answer. We've been hearing this maybe for the last 10 or 20 years. Never did stop us from drinking. Going on, the next sentence. This applies to you and me now. The message which can interest and hold these alcoholic people must have depth and weight. In nearly all cases, their ideals must be grounded in a power greater than themselves if they are to recreate their lives. Now let's think again about what we're instructed to do all the way forward there in that seventh chapter. First, we are to tell them all about ourselves. In other words, we are to parade the horribles. We are to get down and dirty with them. Say, this is exactly what happened to me. This is the way I drank, and this is what happened to me when I drank, and this is what happened when I tried to stop drinking. And then we are to tell them in no uncertain terms what is wrong with them. And then we are to tell them how we recovered, stressing the spiritual freely. And this is at the first meeting. Dr. Silkworth just said it here. There isn't going to be any hope for them unless they're willing to embrace the idea that a power greater than themselves must be the grounding for their ideals, for the principles by which they live. And so when the big book says on page 45 that we are, that this book was written to enable you and me to find that power greater than ourselves which will solve our problem. And it goes on to say that means we've written a book which we believe to be spiritual as well as moral. And this means, it says, we're going to talk about God. So one of the traps we have to be careful of, guys, you guys can make up your own mind about this, but the big book does not have any weasel words in it. It doesn't skirt around this issue at all. We need to make sure that we don't lie to new people. We need to be sure that we don't fall for the siren song that says you don't mention God or higher powers or spirituality to new people. You might scare them off. We need to be aware of the fact that frothy emotional appeal seldom suffices. We need to be aware of the fact that we're going to be telling them that honesty is one of the most important aspects of their recovery program. And yet, in telling them how we recovered, if we leave God out of it, we're lying our heads off. We're leaving out the one thing which is the key to our recovery, that we have accepted a spiritual way of life, that we have sought and have found a power greater than ourselves which has solved our problem. And why would we do that? Out of what kind of fear, I suppose? Or maybe we do it because other people tell us we shouldn't talk about God, or because somebody gets real nasty and jumps up and leaves a meeting or comes across the table, and we just get scared and we say, well, if that's true, then I better soft pedal this God stuff. Or somebody calls us a bleeding deacon or tells us, stop preaching. And we get scared then, because after all, one of our greatest fears is to be rejected and shunned from our group or for any part of our group. The truth is that if we're following the directions in the Big Book, we're going to talk freely about our reliance upon a power greater than ourselves. And we will do as the Big Book does, speak freely of God. Look at the steps. How can you or I take these steps and say, here are the steps that you are going to work if you want what we have? And we see God all over the place. So it doesn't make any sense, does it?
Yes, please. I have a question. Yesterday there was a meeting on the 11th tradition. We were talking about promotion, but be an example rather than by promotion.
Yep.
And I always thought that you reach out your hand when you see another suffering alcoholic and you try to help them. But then, from what I understood in the meeting, was that you wait for them to ask you for help. And so I thought, oh man, so is that what I've been doing, promoting instead of waiting for, you know, them to come up to me for help? So when I try to carry the message, which is the subs, and, you know, speak about this spiritual freely, and how to apply it, then I don't know. Then I don't know if I'm preaching or teaching or what.
Preaching is teaching, isn't it? But the 11th tradition has nothing to do with what you're talking about, does it?
I really don't know.
Okay, look in the back of your book. Let's get this straightened out right now. Look in the back of the book. You'll find the traditions there. You'll find them on page 564. Let's look at the 11th tradition. You see it? Our public relations policy is based on attraction rather than promotion. We need always maintain personal anonymity at the level of press, radio, and film. Got absolutely nothing to do with the way we act and react and interact in our groups. The idea of whether we wait for somebody to come to us or we go to them is a moot point, because you will see a need. If you see a need, you offer your services. Most of the time, people will come to you if you have made yourself available and if they have come to believe that you have something they want. But nevertheless, we're not going to see somebody sitting over where Joni is, who's new and is crying or all scared and everything, and then after the meeting just let them walk out. You're going to go over and talk to that person. You're going to say, how you doing? What can I do to help you? You know, my name is Pete. I mean, we got to use some common sense about this stuff. And a lot of what you're hearing isn't not only is it not common sense, it's not even sense. Okay, that answer your question?
Thank you.
All right, let's go down on page 26 now, xxvi, to the last partial paragraph at the bottom of that page. Men and women drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol. Now the effect, as we're going to describe it for ourselves, most of the time it's going to mean that we're going to be sharing with a new person, for example, that alcohol took away our fear, took away our anxieties, made us feel as if we could do things that we were otherwise afraid